heard the band's songs, The Wait, The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down, and Up on Cripple Creek. It forever changed the world of rock and roll.
I listened and I thought, this is it. This is where music is supposed to have gone, and now someone's finally gone and done it.
Through the triumphs and tragedies, trace the band's musical roots. Discover their vast influence through incredible, never-before-seen archival films, television and concert performances, and candid interviews with the band members themselves, as well as those who played with or influenced their music, including Eric Clapton, George Harrison, Ringo Starr, Emmylou Harris, plus many more. In Rolling Stone's History of Rock and Roll, Ed Ward wrote, "The achievements of this unique group have forever earned them the right to be known simply as The Band." ABC Video is proud to present The Band, the authorized biography. ABC Video is backing the release of The Band with a massive national and local publicity blitz. The Band will be supporting the release with their 1995-96 tour. 12-piece countertop displays are available. Plus, ABC Video has created a one-hour radio show that will be syndicated nationwide, scheduled around the video release of The Band. This powerful promotional piece will get the word out about the video in hundreds of radio markets nationwide. The Band, the authorized biography, only from ABC Video.
Presenting the most spectacular collection of performances in country music today. Get ready for a dazzling lineup of superstars. Real women singing all the heart songs you can handle. Move over, cowboys. It's the Women of Country. An all-star video treasury of award-winning songs and interviews by the biggest names in country music. And it's all here on this two-volume video cassette collection. From Patsy Cline to Grammy Award-winning Mary Chapin Carpenter. The greatest names in country singing their biggest hits. Tanya. Well, it's a little too late to do the right thing now. Emmylou. Winona. It ain't easy to ever say goodbye. Tammy. I'll do my crying.
The Women of Country will be supported with a massive publicity blitz that will include coverage in country music magazines, country radio, and the Nashville Network. Women of Country 12-pack counter displays are available. Watch for the stars of Women of Country this summer and fall as they crisscross the country on their various tours. Coming to you from ABC Video.
I wanna lay down the line. They were grown men, it was once said, who had climbed the mountain together, spoken to the gods, and returned to the valley where once again they became mortal. They wanted to be a band. They became the band.
Poor Neddy of them died, and his wife went crazy too. His mother-in-law never said a word till the insurance man came through. It goes to show you.
Their roots, like so many who came before and most who came after, were nurtured in the rich acoustic blues of the Mississippi Delta.
What makes one person happy is bound to make another one sad.
Once you turn south there at Memphis and start down 51 to the bridge, the air gets heavier and gets damper, and it does feel different. It was a poor place, you know, a strictly farming place with rice and cotton and everybody working hard, but a lot of good times, a lot of people on the street, and a lot of music. As far as growing up, I couldn't have had a better place musically.
It goes to show you, yeah, man, the world is mad.
Right in there in the Delta region, there were Jerry Lee and Elvis and Muddy and Sonny Boy and everybody came from. Right there is where music, hybrids of music, if you want to call it that, gospel influences and hillbilly influences and blues influences got mixed up.
Pass the biscuits, cause it's King Biscuit time here on KFFA Radio.
Featuring legendary bluesman Sonny Boy Williamson, King Biscuit Time was a welcome daily diversion for the hard-working citizens of the Delta region.
It was my main piece of business was to make it over to the radio station, and they didn't care. I'm just a kid coming in off the street. I don't have a crowd with me, so I could get away with it. I would go in, get over in the corner, and watch Sonny Boy and the King Biscuit Band do their radio show. And stop by Habby's Cafe usually and grab myself three donuts for a quarter and have my lunch right there in the radio station. I guess that really put me over, you know, into the blues side of music as far as what I really still favor. I get more fun out of it than the rest of it.
At the same time, a young truck-driving man by the name of Elvis Presley had successfully fused country and blues into a new musical form called rockabilly.
And the first time Elvis came to Helena, he had Scotty and Bill, of course. Bill was playing his doghouse bass, the stand-up bass. Scotty Moore naturally had his Gretsch or Gibson, maybe, plugged into an amplifier. Elvis's guitar, a Martin acoustic, was close enough to his vocal mic that a lot of it would leak into the vocal mic, so it tied together the way a sock cymbal and a snare drum ties the rhythm together. It was working in that behalf. So all of a sudden, then I saw him a couple of months later, and they've added DJ Fontana, and now he's doubling everything that Elvis is doing. He's doubling part of what Bill Black's doing. He's answering Scotty Moore's riffs and just knocking the lights out with them drums. You know, the sound of the cymbals and everything added to Elvis's overall sound. It was one of the best bands you ever heard, those four pieces. And that was the way you looked at it back then. It was Elvis Presley, but it was the Elvis Presley band. That was what you wanted to see.
By the late 50s, musical tastes were changing. Rockabilly had almost run its course, and Elvis departed Sun Records for greener pastures, leaving a gaping hole in the label's roster.
And I got a phone call from some of the session boys from Sun. They were going to give me $100 a week and a place to stay for fronting the session band at Sun. And so, boy, that was big time for me. I thought I'd hit the big time. So I told, of course, everybody I knew, bragging, you know, they chose me to come down and play with the Sun boys, right? Boy, and I loaded up. And by the time I got to Memphis, they'd broken up over who was going to be leader of the band.
Ran into the Hawk, and lo and behold, he's forming a band. Jimmy Ray's going to help him, and there's no drummers. So they asked me if I wanted to volunteer for the job, and of course I wanted to know when we were leaving.
He said, boy, he'd be ready to play. He's ready to play anywhere with anybody. And we started practicing there in West Helena, down that old radio station there. We borrowed Sonny Boy's, Williamson's equipment.
Why, little Willie, you better get back in school.
Fayetteville, Arkansas native Ronnie Hawkins was a rockabilly showman if ever there was one. For Hawkins, the big time was always just around the corner, and he was raring to go.
My family was concerned that somebody in our family finished high school. Back then, that was fairly large accomplishment. Nobody in our family had ever finished high school.
Diamond Helms made it clear to us that Levi was not going anywhere till he got his degree. That's a high school from Marvel, Arkansas degree. He says, man, that way he's got something to fall back on.
I guess because they loved me, they actually saw me as a scholar. You know?
So we sat right there and practiced and learned a few tunes, and then we started going out locally playing the little honky-tonks and then waiting for Levon to get out of school.
An underage drummer with stars in his eyes, Levon would get his real education in the cutthroat roadhouses and beer joints of the Deep South.
Now there, boys, is the DFW pub. You talk about a shithole and a half.
And I said, boys, we're playing in here. He said, you have to show your razor and puke twice before they let you in.
You got to learn to defend yourself, either with a Fender guitar or what I love about the Les Pauls, they were solid. You didn't break your instrument for getting a guy off of you, you know.
And they were pretty rough. If they liked you, we were lucky, because they liked us. But a lot of groups, if they didn't like them, I mean, you better leave.
Or if you had to get it off and swing it, you could still put it back on and play it. I loved them solid-body guitars.
In 1958, the Hawk takes the advice of rockabilly star Conway Twitty and heads for the promised land of the Great White North.
You know, we'd heard all about Canada. We'd dog sleds and igloos, mounties and red coats and all that stuff, because the pictures I'd seen was must have been the Yukon in about 1840.
We took off from Arkansas. He borrowed his sister's car on our first trip, and we headed for Canada. And I think we had a two-week contract with a two-week option.
There's about three or four people in there the first night we started playing, and after about 20 seconds of the first number, they jumped up and run for the exits. Our music was brand new. They hadn't seen that Memphis style rockabilly before, and it just started working. The same thing happened everywhere we went. We went to the Brass Rail after that in London. First night, you know, nobody. Second night, half a house. Third night, lineup. And a lineup from then on. And the same thing happened in the Cock Door in Toronto. It worked out real good for us. We chiseled out a little circuit, you know, between Wynn